Prime Minister Narendra Modi has taken charge in Delhi. During his election campaign, Mr. Modi and his senior party colleagues had threatened to crack down on what they described as illegal migrants from Bangladesh, especially during their campaign in West Bengal and the states of Northeast. That has raised fears that there would be attempts to push back such people again, as it happened during the previous BJP-led India government in the late 1990s. Many of us, of course, do remember the so-called Operation Pushback in the early 1990s. On assuming power, though, Mr. Modi has, however, sent positive signals that he is keen to push ahead deals like Tista water sharing that could not be concluded during the Congress-led EPA government. Indian High Commissioner in Dhaka, Pankaj Saran, has been saying for a while now that a regime change in Delhi will not affect relations with Bangladesh. He had said this much before Mr. Modi took over, even when BJP leaders, including Mr. Modi himself, were threatening to pack off all alleged illegal migrants from Bangladesh. We now have Mr. Saran in our studio to answer our many questions on the future of India-Bangladesh relations. But let us begin by asking him, when is India's new foreign minister, Sushma Swaraj, will visit Dhaka? Hi, Commissioner. Welcome to our studio. So have you really finalized the dates of your foreign minister's visit to Dhaka?
Well, firstly, thank you very much for having me over to this very, very important program. The question of high-level visits between India and Bangladesh is still under discussion, and we're working out the exact dates of the visit, and we will be in a position to make an official announcement when the details have been settled.
So, any likely dates?
Not yet. Dates are under discussion, and as and when we finalize and reach agreement with the government of Bangladesh, we would be making an official announcement.
Our Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina had asked Mr. Modi to make his first foreign visit to Bangladesh. Instead, he's going to Bhutan, and probably his next stop would be Tokyo, if I'm not wrong. But he's sending his foreign minister to Bangladesh on her first visit. What can we in Dhaka read into this?
Well, you know, I don't think it's appropriate to actually discuss, you know, communications or correspondence between two heads of government. So that's the first part of what I would like to say. But having said that, the fact of the matter is that the Prime Minister Modi has accepted the invitation to visit Bangladesh. He's very honored by the invitation, and he definitely looks forward to meeting Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina in the months ahead. And the more important point from my point of view is, how do we proceed with the relationship, and what direction it will take, and what would be the contours and the agenda and the priorities that would be set. So I would like to focus more on the substantive aspects of the relationship.
So does that mean Mr. Modi now wants to assure Bangladesh of its of moving ahead with India's sovereign commitments, but is not in a position to actually go ahead with deals like the Tista water sharing?
And
would he like to come to Dhaka only when he's in a position to sign the deal?
Well, I think there is too much speculation in that question. What I would like to say is that this government, the new government, is committed to its relationship with Bangladesh. I think this was made very, very clear when the Honorable Speaker of the Bangladesh Parliament called on the Prime Minister on the very first day he took over as Prime Minister. And that was a very useful and a very important meeting, because it gave the leaderships of both countries to sit face to face. And they discussed a whole range of issues. And the commitment of this government to taking forward the relationship with Bangladesh was spelt out in very, very clear terms. And it was said that the new government in India is not only committed to maintaining, but also building upon the momentum of the relationship that we have seen in the last few years.
The last time the BJP was in power, New Delhi announced it had no favorites in Dhaka. Former National Security Advisor Brajesh Mishra traveled to Dhaka to congratulate the new Prime Minister Khalida Zia at that time, in what was seen as a clear message that India was prepared to do business with non-Awami League partners or regimes, which is why many BNP leaders seemed very happy when the BJP came back to power this time. Would you now see a return to the policy of no favorites in Dhaka?
Well, I wouldn't put it in such stark terms. What I would like to say is that the government in India does not, as a matter of principle, interfere in the internal affairs of Bangladesh. The question of who leads Bangladesh or who is elected by the people of Bangladesh is something which the people of Bangladesh alone have to decide. As far as India is concerned, we have a track record of dealing with every single government that has actually been in power since the liberation of Bangladesh in 1971. And I think that track record speaks for itself. And with every government, we have made some headway in the relationship in some areas. Yes, admittedly, there have been periods when we have not been able to move as fast as we would have wished. But the fact is that over a period of the last 40 years, the relationship has progressed on almost all sectors. And we are today at a stage when, if you look at the full relationship in its full manifestation, I can say that it is a much more comprehensive and a better integrated relationship than it was in the past.
Coming back to these elections, you know, our January 5th elections, the West, especially the US, has pressed for fresh elections here, saying that January 5th elections were inadequate. And India had then defended that it was a constitutional necessity. Would your new government hold the same view now?
Well, I think at that time what we said was what you have just mentioned, that when we were asked about the election, we had simply observed, as a matter of fact, that in our view, this was a constitutional requirement. We had also said in the same statement that we hoped that the democratic processes would be allowed to continue. Mm-hmm. Now, that was then. Insofar as today is concerned, I think we have to move ahead today. Mm-hmm. And I do not see that issue being revisited today, because today the agenda is different.
So you will never support any non-democratic transfer of power in Bangladesh?
It is not for India to support or not support. I think the primary stakeholder and perhaps the only stakeholder are the people of Bangladesh. I think to expect India to pronounce on elections in Bangladesh would, to my mind, appear to be, from our point of view, a very presumptuous thing to do.
Because I ask this because, you know, Bangladesh has a history of having this unelected governments, military governments, non-democratic governments. So do you think India has a role to play in stopping that?
If you look at the kind of policies that India has pursued since 1947, I think broadly speaking, you will see that we have been very careful about ensuring that democracy takes deep roots within India. And we have built the institutions that are needed to ensure that we actually strengthen democracy within India. When it comes to what happens outside of India's borders, then I think we have a different approach. And that approach is predicated on many, many issues.
But Western powers do that very often, you know.
Well, I think that's basically...
Now, India is also emerging as a big power.
The difference between every country, I would say, you know, has a different approach to how it deals with other countries. In the case of India, we ourselves were at a stage when we were developing our own polity and society and economy. And we were not really in the business of, let's say, promoting democracy overseas. That was not what I would say would be a defining...
If not promoting, what about defending?
Let's say, we have said again and again that how a country governs itself is something which the people have to decide. Insofar as external assistance is concerned, or the role of, say, outside powers is concerned, whether it's a neighbor or whether we are more distant, wherever it is required, wherever we have received a request, we have contributed in other manners. For example, in terms of capacity building, in terms of institution building, in terms of sharing of experiences. So these are the kind of ways in which we have tried to help other countries in strengthening their own democratic institutions. So I would say technical assistance, sharing of experiences, training, capacity building are the things that we have normally done as a matter of practice, whether it's in South Asia, whether it is in Africa, whether it is in other parts of the world. If people say we would like to learn from India about how to conduct an election, or if we want to learn from India about how to strengthen democratic institutions, we have been extremely forthcoming in sharing.
On the question of reciprocity, the present government in Bangladesh has addressed India's many concerns, especially security concerns, rather quite sincerely. I'm sure you would admit that. And the crackdown against the rebel groups from your northeastern region has been a continuous process. I'm sure you'd agree that as the recent arms haul in Hobiganj indicates. But does it not worry you that such huge quantities of heavy weapons like anti-tank weapons, mortars, rocket launchers are finding their way here perhaps on way to your country?
No, absolutely. I mean, this has been a principal thesis of our relationship with Bangladesh for the last many, many years, which is that we have to acknowledge that we have a long border. In fact, in our case, it's the longest border we have with any country. It is one of the most densely populated borders in the world. It is also one of the most
porous
borders. It's porous and poor and densely populated. And the unfortunate fact of this border is that because of the low income levels and low development levels, there is a lot of illegal activity also taking place. Mm-hmm. So we have always maintained that the security of India and the security of Bangladesh are closely interlinked, and that there is no other option except for the two countries to work together mm-hmm. to bring about a border and a border area mm-hmm. which is free from such activities. Neither Bangladesh can do this alone, nor can India do it alone. And if we have that level of political understanding between the leaderships and between the authorities of the two countries, it is only then that you can actually make concrete progress on the ground. Because there are people who are trying to disturb the peace. There are people who are trying to instigate instability in both countries. And I do not think that either country benefits from allowing such forces or such mm-hmm. people to succeed.
So you consider it as a mutual threat for both India and Bangladesh. But most of these weapons originate in China, don't they?
I have no information about where these weapons originate. This is something which I would leave to the investigating agencies. And I think it is entirely their domain. And I would be hardly in a position to comment on that.
So you've said before, regimes change, but interests don't. And so you said a regime change in Delhi will not affect Dhaka-Delhi ties. What are India's permanent interests vis-a-vis Bangladesh that you don't see ever changing?
Well, let me say and clarify what exactly I had said. What I had said was that to the extent that interests of a country as a general proposition, to the extent that the interests of countries remain the same, and to the extent that policy is a function of those interests, then to that extent, policy should also remain more or less the same. Now, when I made that statement, and today, there is a big difference. And the big difference is that you actually have a new government in position. So the questions which were being raised at that time have, to a great extent, been answered.
So is that statement haunting you now?
It's not haunting me. What I'm saying is that today, we have the president has made a statement in parliament outlining the new government's mm-hmm. priorities. And the new government's priorities have been very clearly laid out. Mm-hmm. And those, according to them, we have clearly got a priority for development of an integrated and an interconnected South Asia. Mm-hmm. A South Asia which is prosperous and stable, mm-hmm. and the government is committed to building upon these relationships. Mm-hmm. Now, I would say beyond that, mm-hmm. because these are still early days, mm-hmm. but we have a presentation of a policy framework mm-hmm. already. But in addition to that, because I know that there would be a lot of interest in mm-hmm. Bangladesh mm-hmm. as to what next? Mm-hmm. Here I would only say, let us judge the new government by its actions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now China has already supported the present government in Dhaka, and relations seem to be moving into top gear with the Prime Minister currently visiting China. Has just finished her trip to China. Does this really worry India that Bangladesh and China are moving closer?
Well, I think it's highly presumptuous of me to comment on how Bangladesh pursues its relations with third countries. My remit goes only to the extent of what I do with Bangladesh. So I would not like to comment on how Bangladesh is conducting its foreign policy. That's the prerogative of the government and the people of Bangladesh. Insofar as the specific question of China is concerned, you see, the fact of the matter is that China, India, Bangladesh, Japan, we're all part of the Asian continent. I think it is well understood by now that we are all agreed that we must move towards a regional cooperative framework in Asia, in which we focus on the issues which are of paramount importance to the people of Asia. Our own relationship with China, for example, has evolved considerably in the last 10-20 years. And today, for example, last year, in 2013, bilateral trade was something to the tune of $66 billion mm-hmm. with China. Mm-hmm. And up to June 2012, mm-hmm. the cumulative value of Chinese contracts in India mm-hmm. stood at about $58 billion. Mm-hmm. So you see that there is a new dimension that and a new reality that is taking shape. And that reality is that the Asian continent is beginning to look at itself and to deal with each other and to harness the comparative advantages of all the countries. So I think to the extent that we can move in this path, mm-hmm. it will be good for all the countries.
High Commissioner, we'll continue talking about China. Let's take a break and we'll be right back. Welcome back. High Commissioner, coming back to China, would you be okay with China building the deep sea port at Sonadia, which is being planned, which has been on the cards for a while now? Would not India's strategic experts cry foul again about the Chinese string of pearls around India? Or do you see Sonadia as useful to India to access its northeast?
Well, I think there are two questions in your question. I mean, the one is about Sonadia as a deep sea port, and the second is about a particular country building that port. So I would like to separate the two here. So let me take the second one first. If you're asking me whether we have a view on Bangladesh building a deep sea port in Bangladesh, mm-hmm. somewhere in Bangladesh, let's say in Sonadia, my response to it would be, India will support and welcome any development of infrastructure mm-hmm. which helps to revive and to take the Bangladesh economy forward. Mm-hmm. Insofar as which countries are building or contributing to the port, if there is an investment or an infrastructure development which is what it is, then we would, as I mentioned to you, welcome that development for Bangladesh's economy if it can contribute to regional prosperity. The world is changing, and we have to acknowledge that capital will flow from areas which are surplus to areas which are deficit, and capital and investment will flow where there is demand. So you have a situation where the Chinese are sitting on large reserves of capital and investment. You have a situation where countries like Bangladesh are deficit in capital and investment, and there is a mutuality of interest. Now, we have always said in many forums, both within Asia and globally, and in the you know, multilateral groupings like the Group of 20, the G20 and others, where we work closely with China, that we really need to now begin to move faster in developing a cooperative framework which is unique to Asia and which leverages the strengths of individual countries. Because at the end of the day, what we would like to see for every country and for every member of the Asian continent is effectively more development, more equitable development, more inclusive development. Yes, naturally, our government has said that we will pursue our foreign policy based on enlightened national interest. So, where we do see, if we do see a conflict between the aims which I have described to you and our security aims and our national strategic objectives, then of course there will be that line to cross. But keeping that aside, as a general proposition, the development of infrastructure in Bangladesh is something which, and which helps Bangladesh to develop its economy, is something which we would definitely welcome.
Back to more specific bilateral issue, will India consider a comprehensive agreement on sharing waters in all of all common rivers, as some Indian think tanks have suggested?
Yes, I know that there is a lot of discussion and a lot of work is being done on how do we address the waters issue. The Joint Rivers Commission was created actually in 1972.
But it's not been in best of shape.
It's not been meeting regularly for the last few years.
Why is the case?
Well, I think what happened was that for many reasons, a lot of the discussion was actually taking place outside of the framework of the Joint Rivers Commission. So it was felt that, you know, if you can get your work done through other forums, then let's try that approach. But in the last meeting of the Joint Rivers Commission, we have agreed and we have identified six rivers on which we have agreed that we should begin work on discussing the sharing of these six rivers. This was in addition to Tista and Feni. So I can see at a point in future that this matter will come up for discussion between our two countries, and we will have to wait and see how the two governments can agree on steps on how to move forward.
But if you're bypassing such institutions, agreed frameworks like JRC, then people might lose their faith in such arrangements in future.
No, the Joint Rivers Commission exists. It is a established institutional mechanism. So I'm not suggesting for a moment that we bypass it. I was replying to your question as to why it has not met. The reason it had not met was because we had been able to move forward on some of the issues even outside of the framework. But in every case, we had
but
to.
But do you agree that it is to be made more functional?
Absolutely, more absolutely. It's if you look at the statute that established the Joint Rivers Commission, it is extremely comprehensive, and it contains provisions not just for sharing, but for flood forecasting, for joint studies, for joint management, and it is very, very comprehensive. So it was actually, and it's also very open-ended. So it is not restrictive. It also has a provision for calling emergency meetings should the need arise. So it's a very, very well-structured statute. And there will definitely come a time in the not too distant future when we will have to come back to the table and discuss with Bangladesh the question of water sharing. And I am hopeful that in the coming period, this matter will be discussed again with Bangladesh.
Hi, Commissioner, I have more questions on bilateral issues, but let's take another small break. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Hi, Commissioner. One more bilateral, a major bilateral issue, land boundary agreement. How do you assure us?
Simply that we are committed to its implementation We are committed to its ratification. You know that the current bill for amending the constitution is pending in the Rajya Sabha, which is the upper house, and the government is committed to building a consensus so that it can pass in parliament. And this commitment has been reiterated by our new government, by our new prime minister, to the honorable speaker. So we stand committed to it, and we will try and take all steps necessary to see how we can move forward on this very important issue.
Assam or the West Bengal governments will not be a problem this time.
I would just like to say that we are developing the consensus. There is a new kind of a political configuration in the country after the election. The new government is committed to it.
The new government doesn't need anyone's support. It has
The fact of the matter is that they have an absolute majority, and in the Lok Sabha, and but perhaps not in the Rajya Sabha. But what is important is that they have given an assurance to your government on the very first day of taking over, to be precise, on the 26th of May, that they're committed to implementation, and of course prior to that, the ratification.